Hello, welcome back. I'm Gary Lopez. I'm a principal offensive AI scientist at Microsoft's Adapt team. And this episode, we will be covering PyRIT. So we have talked a lot about how you go about attacking these systems. We have single prompt, we have multi-turns. We have a really good understanding of how to attack these models. We even know about some of the mitigations. But up to this point, everything has been manual. And this is why I really want to introduce PyRIT. So PyRIT is this AI red teaming tool that we built in-house. I'm very happy to say that I am the creator of PyRIT. And then this is an open source tool that we've given to the community to help security professionals and machine learning engineers to red team foundational models and the applications built on top of it. Kind of at the core of PyRIT, is that we want to assist researchers doing their operations to automatically evaluate the robustness of generative AI systems. Right? So the idea here is that PyRIT wants to automate a lot of these AI red teaming tasks so that it would allow operators to then focus on some of the harder to automate and more time-consuming and time-sensitive security tasks. So now, why would you want to use PyRIT? So there are really four main things that we've baked into PyRIT that we think make it very appealing for AI red teaming operators. So the first one is the red team expertise. Right? So we built this tool many years ago, and we've been using it internally quite extensively. So it has a lot of the attack strategies, the prompt converters, and the things that we utilize in our day-to-day operations. The other thing is that it has this concept of efficiency gains, right? Because with PyRIT, we've focused a lot on having reusable components that then you can put into your broader red teaming workflow. Now, because everything is code and you can code with PyRIT, then everything becomes a little bit more reliable because then you can start to execute these workflows in an iterative fashion and then have these repeatable workflows, which is something very useful, especially in the context of AI models that are not always deterministic. And then PyRIT is also very flexible because in the AI red team, when we started doing our operations, we were only taking or were only leveraging the components that we needed that were relevant to the specific operations. Sometimes we have an audio model or a video model or a text model. So we really only want to leverage these components that are very specific to the current operation that we're working on. At a high level architecture, this is how PyRIT works. We have the concept of datasets, orchestrators, converters, targets. We have scoring engines. We have memory, and then we have notebooks that built on top of all of this. So the data sets are, you can think of them as building blocks. These are our jailbreak templates. We have the weapons of mass destruction proxy data set. We have various harm categories objectives that you can just leverage for the specific application that you were working on. Then we have this concept of orchestrators. Orchestrators are things that are performed the end-to-end attack. We can have something like a red teaming bot orchestrator that automatically performs the attack. We have a crescendo orchestrator. We have a scoring orchestrator, a question and answer benchmark orchestrator. So these are like end-to-end workflows. Then we have converters. Right? So for example, you may have some text you may want to translate to another language, or you may have text that want to Base64 encode to utilize it as part of a payload. This will be some of the examples of converters that we have built into PyRIT. Then we have the targets. This could be a text target, it could be an image target, a text-to-speech target, it could be the Gandalf target that we will be demoing in a little bit. And this is how we start to interact with things that are outside of PyRIT. And then we have the scoring engines, right? Because at the end of the day, we're getting a lot of text, images, and video back, and we need a way of scoring what we have. And this is where the scoring engines come into place. At the foundational layer, we have memory, because when you are really working at scale, keeping track of what you sent, when you sent it, and who did it can be quite challenging. So we have memory built into PyRIT. And then if you go to our repository, you'll see that we have a ton of different notebooks that you're going to start to leverage to really understand the different components of PyRIT and how you can start to leverage it. So this is an example of how you would go about doing the standardized prompt generation process. So first, you're going to start with a prompt template. So in this case, it could be something like, I recently had, and you can insert your food item in, then you can put a location, and it was absolutely delicious. Right? So this could be our template. And then the template then allows us to generate multiple prompts because we can start to replace the, in this case, the food item and the food location with, concrete implementations. And you're going to start to see how one template can give you many, many, many different prompts. And then we can, after we have these prompts, then we can start to use even other types of converters. So for example, we can use the Base64 converter, right? So we permutate I recently had pizza in Italy and it was absolutely delicious. And now we encode it with Base64 and then we're able to send this to the model. So we go from one template to many different prompts and each prompt can then, we can apply different converters and then we can increase the variety of text that we're sending to the model significantly. Now, I will show you an example of how PyRIT works based on Gandalf. So Gandalf is a game developed by Lacera. And then the idea here is that it's testing the user's ability to create effective AI prompts. And it really offers us a chance to kind of extract the password out of this little bot and improve our prompt engineering techniques. So in this case, we have PyRIT on the left, and then we have Gandalf on the right. This is level one. How you would go about using PyRIT is you would set up your target, right? So what is powering your target? We give the red teaming bot some instructions. In this case, we're telling the model to extract the password and that it can ask for a password directly. Then we specify which level of Gandalf we are targeting, and then we run effectively a while loop so that the PyRIT can continue to attack Gandalf until it extracts the password. And in this case, we can see that after one turn, we were able to develop a prompt to extract the password, and then we extracted the password that is, in this case, Kakulaku. And then we're able to do all of this automatically with PyRIT. Thank you for joining us on this episode of PyRIT. This is our mascot, Rocky the raccoon. In the team, we always say that only you can prevent AI accidents. To learn more about this training and the labs, please go to aks.com/AIRIT Team 101. Check out our GitHub repo on PyRIT. And yeah, thank you so much. We'll see you next time.